Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Scientia, and thank you for joining us on this fine afternoon. I'd like to issue a special welcome to those of you who made it over from the Rick Smalley Memorial Service that just concluded a few minutes ago across campus. I hope all of you know that we delayed this afternoon's Scientia lecture to give all of you an opportunity to attend both events. I'm Jim Pomerantz, professor of psychology at Rice and director of Scientia, and this is our seventh and penultimate colloquium of the academic year in a colloquium series we're calling simply Animals and Humans. And in this series, we're taking a close look at our complex relationship with the animal world, look at how we interact with animals, how they help shape our view of the world and of ourselves, how they affect our culture, how we benefit from them and how they benefit from us, the risks that are involved in this exchange going in both directions. And today we'll be hearing about a topic that has fascinated and engaged humans for centuries, namely the question of animal intelligence, asking not only how intelligent animals may be, but how we could ever know this with certainty, how we could ever measure or quantify their intelligence. And we're fortunate indeed to have as our speaker today a friend and colleague from across the street, at the University of Texas Health Sciences Center. It would be my pleasure to introduce Dr. Tony Wright in just a moment. But before that, I'd like to give a quick nod of thanks to our two previous colloquium speakers from this spring. We had in January Dr. C.J. Peters from UTMB Galveston talking about bird flu, among other things. And then, of course, just last month in February, we had Dr. Kerry Wolf from Rice's own English department. Let me note that if you missed either of these talks, I believe by now that videos of them are up on the Scientia website. So if you just navigate to our site and click on through, you can bring those up. If the Kerry Wolf one is not up yet, it will be up very, very shortly, as will Dr. Wright's, I hope, within a week or two. Following Dr. Wright's talk this afternoon, we have but one lecture left this academic year, sad to say. On the bright side, that lecture is our premier event of the year, the Bochner Lecture, the only one where we bring in a speaker from out of town and out of state. And in this case, it will be the renowned Dr. Irene Pepperberg from Brandeis University and Harvard University. And for those of you who do not know about Dr. Pepperberg, she is the one who works with her African gray parrot, who's probably at this point more famous than she is, because Alex's cognitive capabilities, including both language and concept formation, are nothing short of extraordinary. And as I think I mentioned last time, for a while we were wondering whether Alex himself would be giving the Bochner lecture, and it turns out that his agent said that he was booked at that time, but that Dr. Pepperberg was free to join us. So we'll be hearing from her. I think you'll come away after this lecture today by Tony Wright and from Irene Pepperberg's Bochner lecture on April 10th, with an appreciation not only for the intelligence of animals, but also for the incredible ingenuity and intelligence of people like Dr. Wright and Dr. Pepperberg, who figure out how you extract answers from animals who can't tell you what it is that they are thinking. Before I introduce Dr. Wright, just note the format. Tony will speak for the usual 55 minutes, and we'll follow that by question and answers, and then a reception with food and drink out in the foyer. So now for the reason why we're here today, and that's to hear from Dr. Anthony Wright, who is a professor in the Department of Neurobiology and Anatomy across the street at the University of Texas Medical School at Houston. That's a quick walk just across Main and Fannin Street, a walk that Tony takes often when he's not riding his bicycle, because Tony is an adjunct professor in my own department, the Department of Psychology, where in fact he is maybe the most active adjunct at Rice from anywhere within the medical center. He teaches Rice students regularly, some of whom are in the room today, in fact, and have gone on after graduating from Rice, even our undergraduates, to work in his laboratory across the street in the medical school. By way of background, Tony received his bachelor's degree from Stanford University in psychology in 1965, and then his PhD from Columbia University in 1971, doing his doctoral dissertation on how pigeons discriminate colors. So if you're wondering how we could ever tell what colors a pigeon can see, given that pigeons aren't particularly talkative, at least compared with African gray parrots, and given that you can't believe half of what pigeons tell you anyway, I think you've come to the right lecture, and you will have an increased appreciation for that in just a few minutes. So after Tony completed his PhD, he moved to Texas, but not to Houston. He started his professional career in the psychology department at UT Austin, and then came down soon after that to become assistant professor of what then was called neural sciences at the Graduate School of Biomedical Sciences at UT Health Sciences Center in Houston. In 76, he became an associate professor, and 82, full professor in the department. In 95, his title changed to professor in the Department of Neurobiology and Anatomy at UT Medical School, which is his title today. As we'll be learning shortly, Tony is one of the world's leading experts in getting animals like monkeys and pigeons to tell us what's going on in their heads, to tell us about their cognitive systems. Just as a veterinarian's job is harder than the job of a doctor who treats humans because animals can't tell you where it hurts, the same is true for cognitive researchers. So they've had to become clever, and in Tony's case, extremely clever, getting animals to cough up their secrets and reveal in their behavior what is going on between their ears. By way of recognition, Tony has served on the editorial boards of several of the top journals in his field, including the Journal of Experimental Psychology, Animal Behavior and Processes, Animal Learning and Behavior, Psychonomic Bulletin Review, and the Journal of the Experimental Analysis of Behavior. Along with that, Tony's published in the very top journals in his field, including Psychological Review, which is arguably the number one journal in all of psychology, and multiple publications in the journal Science, which is arguably the best journal in all of science. Plus, he's published in the Journal of Experimental Psychology, Vision Research, Journal of the Experimental Analysis of Behavior, and many, many others. He served, too, on study sections in Washington for the National Institute of Mental Health. In fact, that's where we met many years ago, serving together on that panel, as well as being a frequent reviewer for the many divisions of the National Institute of Health and the National Science Foundation. Tony's been funded in every year of his whole career, which is remarkable for a person working in the behavioral sciences through all the ups and downs in the funding for science in general and social sciences in particular over the decades. But supporting his work have been various branches of the NIH, including the NIMH, National Institute of Mental Health, NIDA, the Eye Institute, as well as the National Science Foundation, the US Army, and a handful of others. Tony's been honored by his receiving the Fogarty Senior International Fellowship from the University of Auckland in New Zealand, as well as by being the recipient of the prestigious Alexander von Humboldt Prize from Germany. While reviewing Tony's awards, I would be remiss if I failed to mention his recognitions outside the lab, where, among other things, he's won the Houston Men's Tennis Championship for his age group on multiple occasions. Tony is a force to be reckoned with both on and off the court. So let me ask you, as always, to silence your cell phones, pagers, and anything else that makes noise, and tune in to Tony Wright, whose title is Testing Animal Intelligence and Cognition. Tony Wright.
Well, thank you, Jim, for that very nice introduction, and thank you all for coming on this pretty spring day, first day of spring, as a matter of fact. And it's a pleasure to have a chance to tell you about some of my work that I've been doing on testing animal cognitive processes. So I want to say a few words about testing animal intelligence. Testing animal intelligence is kind of a tricky business. In fact, testing animal cognition is a tricky business. But of course, even when you come try to test human intelligence, that's also tricky. So with that as a background, I mean, we all know that animals are intelligent. At least some animals are intelligent. You that have pets or are experienced with animals, you know, they can be very intelligent. So for many years, like the primates, apes and even monkeys are well known to be intelligent. Some of the demonstrations of intelligence, not the kind of anecdotes that we all know about our dog or horse or something like that, some of the first experiments were done with apes on intelligence back in World War II. This is some of curlers, a picture of curlers, apes. He was on the island of Tenerife, and the apes would stack these boxes one on top of another in order to reach the banana up there. So that's been known for many years. And other animals have also shown to be very intelligent, even birds, avians. They're not the bird brains that we once thought they were. So pigeons, let's take pigeons for example. They have a really amazing ability to navigate. Here's a picture of one that's in the Smithsonian that is credited with saving a battalion in World War II by navigating properly to where it needed to go. Other pigeons can navigate by landmarks. In fact, there was in England a series of articles about a particular